And we're back with another episode of Let's Play Pillars of Eternity Blind. I'm the RPG chick. We've just gained this character, Durance.
Yeah.
He's a priest. And he's a little weird. That's right. Can we talk to him?
What?
Can...
Eh?
How do we do that?
No problem.
What?
Thought I felt your eyes on me, Durance says. Now come the words. I had questions I wanted to ask you.
If doubts and curiosity plague you, you're skinning your knuckles on the wrong door.
Why were we supposed to meet? The why of it is you're a watcher. He snorts. A watcher runs two roads of why. For me, it's more a matter of what. There was a time when I wouldn't have spared a thought for your words, or even bothered with you. But now, seeking out watchers is what I do. To put the truth to them, see which of the two ways they bend. He smiles slightly, taunting. Truth? What kind of truth? Either you are a dry field in need of a harvest burning? He frowns for a moment. His eyes flat. Or you're lost in the darkness. Either way, you can see differently from others. He gives a half smile, then his tone becomes accusing. I can tell by the way you notice the staff first off. Not many can see it at first, nor the etchings of the flames, but your eyes. He stares at you, almost eagerly, nodding. Your eyes trace the path. That I could see. So which are you? A dry field, or lost in darkness? Durin's face tenses. The day we don't trade that question back and forth is the day our paths no longer need to be joined. And the trial... Durin's hand clenches his staff. The trial is done. So you don't know either? You know this nation is diseased. Don't need to be a watcher to see it in the children, the politics, the men that stalk the roads with knives in hands and murder in their eyes. This land needs life again. New seeds planted in the burned soil. His voice drops, mocking, and his eyes narrow. And something tells me you can see the path to making that future happen, Watcher. Your kind always does. So then, we need to make sure you see truly now. This nation, its people, don't need any more lies blinding them, nor do I. You test a truth, you don't blindly accept it. And how do you plan to test me? Sharing the road, of course. One truth to match another. Matching each other's pace, keeping rhythm. Other priests can keep their teachings and rantings. For my faith, my teaching, sharing the road is a simple, hard truth. His smile widens and his hands tap against his waist, once, then twice. And when you knock one truth against the leg of another, why, both legs stand firm. But now, if you strike a lie at the knee with the same force, his smile dies and his eyes narrow, why, you make a cripple with but one leg to stand on. Is that why you carry that staff? Is that why I... Durance is about to launch another volley of words, blinks, then he rolls his head back and laughs deeply, the laughter coming until it seems the air will run out of his lungs, until it seems forced. Perhaps your words are worth listening to, Watcher. He frowns, any trace of humor gone, but the truth will win out. Keep pace, and we'll see.
The cost of troubling me seems to worry you little.
I wanted to ask about the region and its history. Durance grunts. Hollowborn, Dealwood, Saints War. Can you tell me about the Hollowborn?
That's a curse that runs deeper. It's a godhammer of a different sort. And like the godhammer, it was made by men's hands.
All things have a price. Left unchecked, faithlessness, virtues, It leaves marks on souls until souls don't have the strength to enter bodies that are gone, that are pure. Gone. The hell I got that from. Animancers, ciphers, all who play games with the fabric of souls are to blame for the barren field they leave behind. Oh, you're not gonna like me then. I'm a cipher. Durance glares at you. Even watchers can do the same. Some simply watch. Others try to weave souls, guide them as surely as Wadwin across Evandur? Doer? He turns away. That is why I correct the Hollowborn when I find them, and the ones whose hands have led to this seed being spilled on the ground. Correct the Hollowborn?
There are fewer souls. There are more vessels. It is simply equaling of the process.
That's murder.
I feel more remorse in putting down a slathering hound. A wicked? Less than a mongrel in its misery. Murder is a kindness, not a crime. Always has been. I would sooner put the blade to those who are to blame instead. If any spirits should be punished, it's theirs.
And who's to blame? The fields of the Deerwood are filled with weakness, ripe for those that play with souls, minds. His face wrinkles in a frown. Animancers in their kind, watchers too, they bear more of the burden than their victims, and more of the punishment. Every year has seen a new crime, the Saints' War, the Hollowborn, and the Salvation. There is no proof watchers are to blame for these events. There are few who can shape a soul in such a fashion. Durin stares at you. And any watcher, any true watcher, born in a Deerwood, would be able to see the crime even if they did not cause it. Silence itself is damning. Why don't you end me then?
Murder you? I would not grant you any of them. The mercy I grant the Hollowborn. You would not be deserving of it.
This is kind of repetitive, like he's already said this. You'd equate murder with mercy?
Murder is an old word. Mercy is letting a soul fly free to the next body. True punishment? Ruining someone to their soul. Crack their spirit like you would crack their skulls with a staff. Beat them. Hurt them in mind and body. So their souls become shards. But you leave it inside the vessel, like a bag of glass, to either choke on it or pass it through their bloody stool.
Well, that's an interesting observation. Interesting. I don't know what the word I'm looking for. It's a... I know what it is. I can't think of the freaking word.
Then, leave it in the body to think on it. Like planting a new field with the right seed.
He makes a locking motion with a twist of his hand, then grins, satisfied. That sounds like you've committed it to memory.
Many marks may I make upon your flesh. But flame leaves marks that cannot heal. Magrin doctrine dictates true punishment is one that remains in memory. In memory. In the soul. In the flesh. Even should the victims die, slowly or swift, sometimes by their own hand afterwards, the lesson lingers, burned in their flesh.
That seems harsh.
Have you seen a man branded by flame? He remembers it always, in every waking movement. It is a lesson writ in the only ink and vellum that matters, blood and flesh. One can burn the soul as well. It is an art, and I do not take pleasure in it. But there is more at stake here than forgiveness. Many of Aethys's faith were punished in the purges following the Saints' War, and the ones that harmed children. they suffered worse.
What do you mean?
We did what must be done. Wherever they were rooted out, their souls reclaimed. And if they couldn't be reclaimed, we ensured they would never inhabit another body.
We still got a lot of stuff to ask him. So we've only asked about that now. Do you know anything of the Deerwood and the surrounding nations? Deerwood's the best of them. Still has spirit, if a land can have one. It's a place where a man can walk freely, even make new roads, and that's a rare thing in this world. Its generations, however, are damned, so no new footfalls may spell an end to it. Do you mean the Hollowborn? Yes, Aethas' last stab at revenge after he was ended. Durance frowns. Aethas was the god of rebirth, and his light does not fall on the Deerwood. I've heard some claim it's his doing, his death. It's closed the halls to new souls. He scoffs. I don't believe it. The problem is closer to that than that, and as always, it involves women and men, and they are always circling, within and without. The Valian Republics, Red Saras, the Saints' War, one big bladed spiral shredding everything around it. How do you feel about the Valian Republics? Durance snorts. Fortune seekers garbed in robes of office, manipulators, traitors, and traitors, all. Huh. Let's not reveal that yet. Don't hold them in high regard? Durance grunts. Any country so obsessed with style might as well be wearing scarves over their eyes. Keep vigilant, or they'll turn you into slaves as soon as ink dries on the trade treaty. The Deerwood and its internal riches is too tempting, especially if someone else tames the country and the face painters for them. Face painters? Durance waves his hand dismissively. Tribes, Glamfellens, cluster around the ruins like flies. What about Red Saras? Durance's face flushes, and a sheen of sweat forms on his brow. A controversial question. Too many adjectives to that so-called nation. Civil unrest, economic collapse, all tinder, just needing the right spark. Some farmer shows up, takes a god into himself, and then takes a crown on his head. That word I was trying to think of is, it always came to me, too. It's when you compare something to something else. God, I care. It's on the tip of my tongue. I know what it is, too. As soon as I finish the episode, I'll remember. This divine kingdom he tries to set up goes about as well as you'd expect. A trickle of sweat runs down the side of Durance's cheek and sinks into his beard. Suddenly, the population of heretics goes up by about half and again, and Aethas starts turning his blood-stained gaze to every blasphemer he can find. Cleaning a house is one way to put it. His face darkens, and his eyes narrow. Purge is another. Put them and their god in their place, though, with enough force to kill that damned country, too. Not a supporter of the country of Red Saras. Aloth passes by casually, muttering under his breath. Surely you know where this is going by now. It's not a... See how what I mean? These characters... I think you end up betting off having the characters that are put into the game. It's not a country. It's a gathering of cowards and your puppets. They used to be an optimistic bunch. A bright bunch. Durance laughs at Bright as if a private joke. Was their undoing. Should have embraced their misery without letting a farmer lead them to a brighter ruin. Almost Aethas puppets, too. Put an end to that. They dangled on his strings. Widewind dangled on theirs. They would never have any success on the battlefield had not their god come down. The Saints' War, Durance snarls, needed to call on their god to have a chance. Tell me about the Saints' War. Durance's eyebrows draw together in a frown, then he grunts. keep forgetting your feet are new to the Deerwood. The Saints' War.
Wasn't a war. It was a god stepping past himself. The country of Rhea and Saris and all their heathens. They're paying for it now. Although by my count, the fire should have roared through their country with more force, catching all their souls. Truth, it wasn't even a war. It was a cautionary tale about pride. Specifically, Widewind's pride. He should have stayed a farmer.
I love the voice acting in this game, guys, and the way, like, every once in a while it pops up. I like that. What happened? Was, what, 15, 16 years ago? 2807? Durance pauses, then shakes his head and shrugs. My memories are back with a younger me. I don't hold on to dates. I hold on to actions and causes. The war was an act of arrogance, born straight from Riad Saris's twitching legs. A man thinking himself more than a man. Durance snorts. Want to kill someone? Tell him a god speaks through him. Then tell him he means him to lead, which puts him at the front of any army. And the army was as strong as you expect for Riad Saris, as sick as that country was to begin with, yet a war was likely just what they needed. What was wrong with the country? Riad Saris had its share of troubles. It deserves all of them. It deserved Widewind. He was the light that led them to flame. Riad Saris was in decline, Aedir poison already eating its veins. Economic bleeding, the dying of their faith. Durance frowns. Then Widewind, this farmer, claims to take up Aethas in the flesh, and gives them the worst kind of hope. What happened then? They crown him. Durance taps his head, making a slight bow, and when his face turns back to you, he's wearing a feral smile. They make him king, the worst kind of blasphemy. And once he wears the crown on his head and the god in his flesh, why, he starts making changes. Divine changes. Durance's eyes blaze. Then he decides he's going to change us. Save us. How? He marches on to the Deerwood to free us. To free us from our beliefs, like he freed the other souls in Riad Saris. Cold Morn offers up its belly with no resistance, and it's spared. Durance snarls. The bloodshed starts when he attacks Mercy, when he sacks Mercy Vale. A touch of irony that puts it to the flame. Cold Morn? Durance spits, snarls. Cowards, and Cold Morn is an apt name for them. They lay still, frozen, while their fellows burned. They'll pay Magrin's price one day for such cowardice. What did Aethas do next? Aethas keeps marching. Deerwood takes to the trees, cutting at his flanks, his scouts, his troops. It seemed near hopeless. Durance's face becomes grim, then smiles slightly, until Halgat's citadel, the Godhammer. This guy's a lot of dialogue. There we put him to the flame, burn the god out of him, if there ever was one to begin with. Dozen brave men and women take to the bridge, make a stand. Then we torched him there with the fire of the Godhammer. What is the Godhammer?
Gods have taken flesh, in all respects, taking willing and unwilling vessels. It's not a violation, it's what gods do. As long as they accept all that comes with it. Men are weak. Gods? Well, we showed old Widewind that he was flesh and blood, no matter how much light was pouring out of his farmer's hands. Took men of faith to build a weapon. A godhammer. Judgment. Proved him dead at Halgot's Citadel.
It was the weapon of Deerwood's people. Their independence. There are few that would deny that Aethas overstepped. The Godhammer reminded Aethas of this. A fire and force so terrifying, so bright, it burned a god away. Durance holds his staff and his hands lock around it, tracing the etchings. As you watch, the top of the staff blossoms, burns brightly, and Durance speaks, his face illuminated in the fire. A weapon that would burn brighter than Aethas. And we led him to it and burned him at the stake. The stake was the god hammer, and we impaled him on it. Did he say? Who fashioned it? I'm not sure if he said. This nation did, yes, with its faithful. We weren't going to stand for any more. Any more should be two words on. We didn't need a pretender in a vessel. We primed another vessel and then let it fly. It took only taunts by men, and that was enough to lure him across the bridge and right into the new sun. Let Red Saras see how bright their arrogance had become, and became a symbol by which we answered their purge with one of our own. Purges?
We started saving the Aothasians from themselves, burning any that didn't die with their god. Heresy in Red Saras is one thing. Heresy here in the Deerwood comes with a more personal.
Why the purges?
As I see it, every Aothasian who still lives in the Deerwood puts the nation at risk. Is another dagger held to the throat of our faith. Root them out, burn them, or send them back to Red Saras to wallow in the blood of their failure.
He really is not fond of them. Oh, he doesn't want to answer anymore. Keep troubling me, and I may extend the tithe bowl for each question. Enough questions for now. Let the road keep us until the next campfire. But I want to talk to you.
Yeah?
What?
What must you say now?
If doubts and curiosity plague you, you're skinning your knuckles on the wrong door.
Huh. Are you a servant of Whale? Let mysteries and questions remain with him, at least until the next time we need rest. Okay, is he gonna...
Sure.
Hmm?
Maybe he'll tell me about himself.
If doubts and curiosity plague you, you're skinning your knuckles on the wrong door.
Tell me about Magrin. Do you have whale's eyes painted on your skin? There's more mysteries than questions, and even a marching force of answers won't placate you. Even soldiers need to let their thoughts settle, just as their priests do. Alright, one more. Hmm? How do I do it?
Yeah. If doubts and curiosity plague.
Huh, okay, he'll tell me about himself, possibly. He grunts. Where are you from?
Where I hail from? From one of Magrin's fires. A cathedral. Ashfall. Made of blackened trees.
Durance sighs, his hands tightening on the staff for a moment, then relaxes.
I studied the scriptures there. The fires carved into the land. The trunks of the burnt trees. And in the factories where the rifles and cartridges were shaped. All our chapels in other devotions.
Other devotions? Durance nods. For Magrin, any fire is enough for worship, physical or not. A blacksmith's anvil, a craftsman's bench, all arenas where fire is waiting to be born. Durance snaps his finger. It just needs a spark, like an alchemical fire, or a spark to cartridges to speed them to their purpose. Their purpose? Durance tilts his head, thinking, well, their purpose then. It was many thens ago. Durance scratches his beard. Beard was a little brighter than now. But yes, cartridges, guns all had a purpose, and that purpose was punching holes in mages and letting their pompous air hiss out. Durance gives a half smile, then a nod. Woke their kind right up and kept staring at the ceiling in the dark instead of sleeping. That's for certain. I was wondering about Aeloth there. Aeloth rolls his eyes. Pompous air, indeed. A little violence as an accounting, an answer for unchecked power. Well, Magwin gave an answer for that. Magwin put soldiers and mages on equal footing? Durance nods again. Mages were troublesome in that time. Firearms made every man a mage, and a caster's pretty arcane shield was little match for them. It turned each commoner into a beast that could spit fire. It leveled the field of battle, that's for certain. Made many a mage a grave. Tell me more about Ashfall. It's as if you swallowed a gadfly nest. Keep silent and keep them to yourself, lest you tire yourself before the next campfire. All right, he's done.